Hello everyone and welcome to another video on M&D Fantasy Corner. I'm Duncan and with me as always is my friend Momo.
Hello everybody, and I noticed you changed something in this intro.
Yeah, because I don't really consider this like a podcast.
Man, I noticed that you changed something, but I was not sure what.
It's video. I just put instead of podcast episode, video episode. But yeah, what I wanted to say, this is going to be a little bit different video. Most of our episodes are generally aimed at our, you know, listeners. Basically, people who are already love Malazan. But this video is more aimed, at least half of it, is aimed towards the new people who maybe wanna try Malazan, and we wanna simply riff off some strengths of it. And this is why this video is titled, Is Malazan for You?
If you guys remember, at the end of Gardens of the Moon, we did kinda some in-between episodes. So we decided after every book we will do some like bonus episode.
Yes, but you know, the second part of this video is going to be a fun cast of, we selected 10 characters from Deadhouse Gates, so you know, even our regular listeners will have something for them too in this video.
I mean, I think even somebody who read Malazan will probably listen even the first half where, you know, I know that I usually do because I'm in general curious why do people find Malazan. You know, why they like it so much.
I think we should start now because, I don't know, we usually ramble and this video should probably be a little bit more laser focused. So I don't know if you want to start first.
You go.
Okay, so for me, I selected first thing. There is something extremely unique about this series. And that thing is that it's written by two authors. One is Steven Erikson, other is Ian Esslemont. So you might be wondering, why is that important? Who cares if two people are writing this series? Well, I care for one, and here is why. You can ask yourself, what type of fantasy reader are you? Would trilogy satisfy you? Is trilogy your preference?
No.
What about two? Yeah, that's what I'm saying. For example, to me, I started long time ago, I started with Song of Ice and Fire. I finished 5 books quickly, and that left void inside of me. Then I jumped on Wheel of Time, and I realized, okay, here I have like 15 books. This is much more suited for me. And that's why, for example, the next fantasy that I was looking for, I wanted something that is bigger. Malazan has already 21 books. And this is not just like, I don't know, out of order books. We have Malazan Book of the Fallen series that is 10 books length and it's already finished, that's Steven Erikson. Then also he started working on Karkana's trilogy, he already finished 2 books of this, and he is planning another trilogy already. Then Esslemont, he has his own Novels of the Malazan Empire, 6 books already finished, then he has another trilogy, Path to Ascendancy, that's also already finished. There are rumors that he's starting new trilogy.
Basically, reason why you like that this universe has two authors is quantity.
Yes, I want quantity. It's simply trilogies and short series that do not satisfy me at all.
I understand, but you know, I think there are more like pluses of having two authors, man. It's like you are having two perspectives. And I think, you know, two people can create like more detailed world than one guy could. I don't know if this makes sense.
It does make sense. Some people would argue against this because there is general perception that, for example, people prefer Steven Erikson books much more. But my counter argument to that is, okay, let's assume that you wanted Steven Erikson to write Novels of Malazan Empire and Path to Ascendancy. Do you see how unrealistic that is? He would probably need another 18 years to finish that. There is no time simply to write this many books for one person. So to me, it's always bonus to have another person writing in this universe.
Yeah, man, but your first, you know, like point is double-edged sword. Because, you know, while people like you and me and lot of other people really prefer like, you know, lot of books in series, I think that there is almost equal amount of people, when you recommend the Malazan and when you say it's 20 books, they are like, oh man, that is huge time commitment. I'm not ready to go into that.
Yes, but I mean, I want to be transparent in this video, guys. I don't want to lie or sugarcoat it. This is what is Malazan. If you are type of person who loves long projects, long fantasies, Malazan is for you. If you are, on the other hand, somebody who doesn't have as much time and you are enjoying like short snacks of fantasy, you know, maybe Malazan is not for you, because you are definitely not going to understand it and you are definitely not going to get into it. So that's, you know, my first point, I guess.
Okay, is it my turn?
It's your turn.
Man, you know, I'm worried, man, that, you know, after people listen to, you know, your first point and my first point, they will like say, okay, Malazan is not for us. Because reason because reason why I like Malazan, man, is because it's one of the more mature fantasy works. And not, you know, when I say mature, I mean in terms of complexity, in terms of themes, in terms of settings, everything. Basically, what I'm trying to say first, this is not, in my opinion, and you know, I'm sure after I say this, there will be somebody who say, okay, I'm 18 year old and I like this book. But in general, I think that this series would not appeal to, you know, like somebody 17, 18, 19 years old. It's, how can I explain this? I read quite a lot of fantasy books. And generally, when I'm reading those fantasy books, I let my brain go on basically like auto. I just kind of turn it off. I'm reading. You cannot do that in Malazan, man. This book requires your concentration. And that is why, for example, you know, I could binge read Wheel of Time in basically like maybe 2 months. And Malazan, for me at least, it's impossible. Because every book after I read, after I finish it, I feel kind of drained. I feel tired. Because every page you need to pay attention. And this book make you work hard for every piece of information. And not only that, but you know, I think I mentioned this in previous episode. This book from the very beginning set the stage that you cannot relax. If you like some character, you are in every fucking book, you are worried, you are wondering, oh my god, will this guy die in this book? And guess what? He probably will. And it will probably break your heart.
But you know, your first point that you just said is exactly the reason why I started Malazan. It was because it was difficult. It was assaulting my brain. I wanted that. And for example, if I was listening to this video, I would, you know, I would read it. That would lure me, because I'm that type of dude.
But for example, let me ask you this. You are reading now parallel Stormlight Archives. And I honestly think there are only 3 books. I honestly think that if we didn't do this format of Stormlight Archives, I think you would devour those 3 books in like 2 weeks. Can you imagine reading like Deadhouse Gates, Memories of Ice, and House of Chains in 2-3 weeks?
You know, I see your point.
It's not that they are bad, man, but because you know we just now finished Deadhouse Gates, and when you are first time reading, when you come to the end, and when you read what happened at the end, you feel devastated, man. You need fucking time to heal. I honestly think if somebody forced me to read second and third book back to back, that I would probably try to kill myself, man. Because I would be so, you know, so sad. These books break your heart. But somehow, man, I say this a lot. People started this trend because of Game of Thrones. Now they are like saying, okay, you know, main characters need to die in every book. Yeah, I agree kind of with that. But I don't like, there will probably be now authors that will kind of force that type of, I don't know how to call it, fantasy or whatever. But man, in this book, in Malazan Book of the Fallen, these deaths never felt like forced to me. They never felt like something that Steven is doing just, you know, so he surprise you or fuck with you. They felt like very natural.
I think what helped in that also is that there is no like a central, strong main character, for example, like Daenerys or Jon Snow. Here, it's more like spread out, more chill.
Yes, but you know, I also was speaking about that in previous episode, when at the very beginning of the series, in like book 2, author set the, you know, bar that he's willing. He show you that he's willing to kill pretty much everybody. It really changed your experience in future books. Because, you know, usually when I was reading, I don't know, Wheel of Time, after a couple of books, I realized that, you know, this author is not killing his characters. So any trouble that characters get into, I was kind of a little bit worried, but in the back of my head, there was always thought, no matter what happened, these guys will survive. I never, for a minute, had that feeling when I was reading Malazan. Every moment I was like sitting on needles thinking, oh my god, please don't kill this guy. Because threat is real in every fucking chapter that this guy will die. And know, you know, the best thing is that it doesn't have to be some epic moment. He can just die, I don't know, get the rock in the head.
True, that's 100% true, guys.
And that really, really change perspective when you are reading.
Shall I go with my another point?
Yes, yes.
This Erikson said this, and I 100% of course agree. These guys, it is fiction, but it's like fictional history. And this series is extremely tied to history because both of these authors, they are actually archaeologists.
Is Esslemont archaeologist too?
Yes, both of them are archaeologists. You know, you will find that these books are influenced a lot by history. So here's my question to you guys. Are you somebody that, for example, in high school, elementary, or maybe even in university, are you someone who enjoyed history? Because me, personally, that was one of my favorite subjects to study. I loved everything about it. I loved to learn history. And even after I finished school, I still sometimes like to, I don't know, read on Wikipedia about some historic events, watch some YouTube videos about history. So if your answer to this question is yes, I do love history, then more likely than not, you are also gonna love Malazan. Because this is, like I said, it is fiction, but it's history. It's realistic, even though it's fiction. And for example, I would go as far as to say, for example, in universities, I would suggest highly that every university has like an optional subject that is based on Malazan, where students can choose to try to, I don't know, tackle it, understand it. Because, you know, these students, they should know that there is another job, another possibility. They don't need to be archaeologists. They don't need to be professors of history. They don't need to be historians. They could be also fantasy writers. And who would benefit the most from that?
We.
Of course, we would benefit from that because that's Man, amazing. I want more Erikson.
You are just trying to lure people into writing more fantasy so you have something to read.
Yes, and I want more fantasy that's similar to this because I truly... Every time I find some reference to something from our real history, I geeked out because I truly love, I'm passionate about history. So why not? I want more historians to write fiction. Is that, you know, is that a crime?
Yes, that's very selfish. You are
is it a crime that I'm making this video about me?
Fuck you, historians. Fuck, you know, working at schools. Go write fucking fantasy books.
Yes, go. But yeah, that would be my second point, I guess.
Okay, my second point is a little bit complicated because I'm usually not the guy that care about that. Actually, I'm the guy that get mad at people shitting about these things. And that is, you know, like representation of, I don't know, women, I don't know, race, religion, like diversity in books. I was never I never cared too much. Like, I was reading Lord of the Rings. There was basically no sexuality in there. There was basically no... It was just white people, basically, right?
Basically, almost no women.
Yes, and I never had problem with that, honestly. What I had problem with, for example, you know, I'm a huge fan also of Wheel of Time. And now, you know, there is TV show coming, and I'm a member of a couple of groups on Facebook and on some forums of about Wheel of Time. And what always pissed me very, very much is what character should be made gay for the purpose of TV show. And I was always, you know, like, why the fuck would you do that? Why the fuck would you change author, I don't know, for no reason, why would you change somebody's sexuality? I don't know if you get what I'm saying.
I get it and I agree 100% with you.
But here, man, in Malazan, diversity is everywhere. Especially in Malazan army, man. Women are fucking equal to men. And best of all, it never felt like author is forcing it on us. It felt very natural to me in Wheel of Time. I love it. But you know, women are written little, let's call it ham-fisted. Robert Jordan didn't really get the good grasp on it. For example, in that Sword of the Truth, or whatever that shit is named, I swear women were like fucking objects. Nothing more there. But there are also some fantasy that go other way, that they are trying too hard to be diverse, and they are trying too hard to put, you know, oh, this woman, she will be as strong as any man, but you know, it doesn't feel natural, it feels forced. But in Malazan, man, it felt very, very natural, at least to me. And I was saying, in Guardians of the Moon, I didn't even realize until we did Funcast of Guardians of the Moon, how many actually characters are black. Or wear black without me even, like, noticing it. I don't know if you remember when we were doing a fan cast for Guardians of the Moon, you know, in the middle of, you know, I choose some actor to play it, and you said to me, oh, man, but this dude is black originally. And I needed, you know, to actually go find, and yeah, he really is black. It was not important. I don't know how to explain it.
Man, you are explaining it perfectly. It is that's it. It's not important what color skin of character is. It's not important what gender it is. Malazan universe is simply like that.
Yes, and especially, man, what I like is Malazan military, man. Because there, you don't give a fuck. Are you shemale? We don't give a fuck, man. Here, take this fucking cusser and throw it at enemy. GG, well played. Also, one trope that I... No, I don't hate it. I don't even dislike it. But it's kind of, you know, worn out trope of damsel in distress. There is no that trope in Malazan. I mean, there are a couple of situations where somebody need to save a woman, but there are also situations where women need to save a man.
Man, there are couples where women is actually much stronger than male.
Yes, exactly. And, you know, I really found that refreshing. But, you know, I need to add one small thing. I think he really captured the essence of soldiering. This, for me, is like most believable representation of soldier's life in fantasy that I ever read. There are, you know, like million other things that I like, but, you know...
We can never do justice to Malazan, because if we wanted... We could probably make this 20-hour show, and we could just speak about stuff that we love about Malazan. But as Mohammed said, we simply do not have time. We kind of want these videos to be, like, you know, normal size.
I will just tell you, like I swear, a couple of hours before we are recording this episode, I'm scrolling on YouTube, and I find some video, not video, actually, it was blog post. I think it was BuzzFeed. And they ranked 52 best fantasy series. And when I saw that Malazan is number 25, I swear to you, I fucking raged, man.
And man, that's not bad.
Man, that's terrible. But worst thing is, man, after that, I read on number 17 was that fucking god-awful Sword of Truth series.
Oh.
And I cannot understand how somebody who actually read those two series can even put them on the same fucking list, man. I understand that Malazan, you know, you maybe read it and you feel it's not for you. I read a couple of books like King Killer Chronicles. It's, you know, planned trilogy, two books are out for now. And if you Google it, you will see that it's almost on any list in top five. And I understand why it's in top five. I understand that it's a good book. But if you put fucking Sword of Truth, or I don't know, Inheritance Cycle of that Paulini, I'm not sure what his name is. If you put those in front of fucking Malazan, you don't know what the fuck you are talking about.
You are now making me want to read that Sword of Truth because, you know, how bad can it be?
Man, like, just imagine, man, you read like 20 more fantasy series and you steal from each of those series. Man, there is fucking Gollum in that book. I swear. And I think his name is not Smeagol, it's Steven. And he even saying, you know, instead of my precious... You know, I forgot what he said. It's fucking ripoff, 100%. Bad guy is, their name is not Sith from Star Wars, but it's Mord Sith. He stole like from two books' names and put them together and he get his bad guy.
So he's not even hiding the fact that he's stealing.
It's terrible.
What if I liked this book? Would that be like friendship ending move?
I mean... It wouldn't, but you know how it spit on you, probably.
Okay, but shall we go with our tradition?
Okay, we actually can.
I don't know if you want to go first or me.
You go first.
Okay, so this is my Felicin. My Felicin is named Shailene Woodley.
I don't like your Felicin. I don't like this actress. Do you like mine?
But what is the name of your actress?
She is from that TV show Modern Family, and her name is Ariel Winter. I think she would be perfect for this role.
They kind of both look like Felicin to
me. Yes, but I think, you know, this Ariel Winter is younger and, you know, more innocent looking.
Guys, you can also vote who you liked more in the end somewhere in the comments. But shall we go with the second?
Heborik?
Yeah, Heborik is next.
Okay.
So I'll send you mine.
Here's mine.
Ben Kingsley.
When I was reading Heborik, I always imagined this actor, Ben Kingsley, from that movie when he played Mahatma Gandhi.
Here is the thing, I'm going to admit something. This was not originally my idea. Somebody in the last video sent a comment and wrote this guy as Heborik. I checked it and, you know, it was almost 100% exactly how I imagined it. So no credit for this one.
Here is the thing. I was sure that this was completely my idea. But apparently, man, I read in past that, you know, post and, you know, it influenced me too.
Look at your photo. He actually has even tattoos.
Yes, I found one with tattoos.
Next one is Bowden.
Oh, I identify Bowden, man. I gotta admit
that. Okay, so I found Bowden, but this guy is...
Send it.
He's mounted from Game of Thrones.
Nah, I don't.
Thing is, this guy is too big,
yes.
And he would probably be better used as, I don't know, Trell or some Jagut or somebody like simply huge, maybe even Karsten.
I mean, Bowden is big, but he's not as big as Mountain.
But you know why I chose this guy? Because his face is kind of how I imagine Bowden, like kind of ugly-ish, brutish type of dude.
Yeah, maybe, but you know, I think he's too big.
He is definitely too big, but that's
I was really blanking on Bowden. And we originally planned even to, you know, do casting for Kulp, but neither me nor Duncan could find Kulp. So we cut him out, guys.
Yes. Okay, so Duker, I think everybody also agree, but this guy is too old.
I mean, he is too old, but this is... Did you choose, man? What the fuck, man? I was proud of this pick too. And you fucking stole it from me.
Of course, it was expected. Man. Of course, he's Morgan Freeman.
But you know,
the voice, the elegance of the man.
Yes, and you know, he's also black and old. Everything.
It's perfect.
Everything fits. But you know, I think he might be too old to actually play somebody who is soldier.
Of course, man, I just said he's too old, but guys, we are not making a real cast, like I said, I need to remind this. This is just us having a fun.
I swear to you, a couple of years ago, he would be perfect. Perfect.
Of course. But our next pick, this one is going to be like...
Coltane?
I don't know. I think we are going to be different here.
Okay, my pick, and I will admit that I think I stole it from somewhere. I'm not sure where I stole it from.
Man, I stole all of this.
You are fucking proud, man.
I'm not proud, I'm just honest. None of this is my... Actually, Malik Rel, I made mine.
There are a couple of mine here. I know Morgan Freeman was mine, but you know, apparently it was everybody's. But this is my Coltane.
Okay, I feel that I have better Coltane.
And you know, this guy's name is Lou Diamond Phillips. And you know, he has that Native American feel.
But you choose the picture, he looks so like elegant, and Coltane is so...
There was no picture, you know, of him to be some war leader. Yeah, sure.
Okay, so here is my Coltane. This gentleman's name is Adam Beach. I hope that I'm pronouncing it correctly.
He's the guy from Suicide Squad.
I have no idea from where he is, yes, but when I saw his face, he kind of has that commanding aura.
I know.
And he has, I don't know, he looks, this is how roughly I imagine Coltane.
I honestly am not sure. He looked too cheery. He looked too cheery for me.
But maybe this guy has like a big range. Maybe he can be a little bit more serious.
It's possible. But you know, for my next pick, like I said, you know, Bolt is, he's supposed to be Native American also.
Let me just say, you are not winning this one. I think my Bolt is perfect.
Here is my Bolt, man. And you know what is the hint for it? Uncle.
What?
Uncle. And look at this beauty.
I'm gonna destroy you on this pick.
Man, this is Clive Russell. He's Blackfish from Game of Thrones.
But he has too pretty of a face.
No, man, he doesn't. And you know, do some makeup on him. Get him
do
some
you know
cut.
How Bolt was described as ugly? You know, that they needed to find him a blind woman.
I know. Show me yours, motherfucker.
Look at this face. Tell me this is not Bolt.
Oh, fuck.
This name is Danny Trejo.
I'm giving it to you. How the fuck I didn't think about... Man, I know this dude. This will make me lose.
I'm so proud of this
pick. But, you know, I think my Iskaral will maybe equalize it.
Maybe if your Iskaral satisfy me, I'm gonna give you a win.
So far, man, you know, you are leading by pure, just because of Bolt.
But shall we go with Stormy?
Okay, here is the thing, man. My next is kind of together, Gessler and Stormy. I really like these two guys' chemistry from Game of Thrones.
I'm gonna give it to you.
This is, you know, Hound and Tormund. Tormund is Stormy, and, you know, Stormy has beard also.
You know what's scary, man? I almost picked both of these two.
Really?
Yeah. Apparently, man, we are now picking almost everything same.
Oh, Danny Trejo will destroy me.
So this is the... Of course, this guy is Stormy. There is
Stormy
no
is 100%.
Question.
I wasn't sure about Gessler, but I really liked, you know, their conversations from Game of Thrones. So, you know, I kind of want to see more of them together.
Man, I definitely agree with you here. You know, my Gessler is... Okay, I'll choose
this
guy.
Can you imagine this guy, you know, playing Gessler and telling that story about when he dressed as some woman and Gessler fucked him?
Yeah. Oh my god, this Stormy?
Yes.
Like Canis Harlot,
yes,
I think they
yes.
said. Okay, I think you equalized because this is my Gessler.
That is vanilla. No.
You know, I'm buying your more.
Okay, now, next is Iskaral, right?
Yes, I couldn't find Iskaral because some of you already know this, but Iskaral is my favorite character. And when I'm kind of obsessed with something, you know, it's hard for me to find something that is worthy of Iskaral. It needs to be perfect. So I couldn't find somebody who is like how I imagined him. But let's see your crack at it.
I don't know if you know this actor.
I know him, but
man, this guy is crazy enough to play Escape. First of all, he's one of the greatest actors alive.
And here is my only thing that why I cannot accept him.
Why?
It's because this girl is black.
Yes.
And
I know.
I understand your, you know, I
a
understand
man, who
your
is black,
your
crazy black actor.
Well, I don't know, there must be some.
Nobody is crazy who have crazy energy as fucking William Dafoe. This guy is crazy in real life. Look at his face, man. Look at his face. This is his Karal looking at you when he's trolling you.
Yes, but I'm rejecting your
fuck
suggestion.
You, man. Fuck you.
This is what I need you guys to find me perfect this Karal.
Who else
okay,
we have?
Okay, so the final one is Malik Rel.
I didn't find nobody for Malik Rel.
Okay, so for Malik Rel, guys, I have chosen this because simply I don't think there's an actor. Yeah.
Hey.
There, I cannot find somebody more disgusting for this role. And this guy always kind of reminded me of Malik Rel.
Well, you know, when I saw this picture, I understood. Okay, this is fitting, but you know, obviously Malik Rel is human. But you know, since you were shitty to me on Iskar, I'll push, you'll get 0 points for this.
You know, we are not the judges. The judges will be people. I think last time people loved your picks more. So guys,
I'm afraid
cast
now.
Your votes. Select the new winner.
Thing is, man, we are sharing like at least three together. We are sharing Duiker, Heborik and Stormy.
But there is enough difference.
Yeah. But anyway, I think this is it, right?
Yeah, pretty much next week, if we make a video, it's going to be Memories of Ice.
Finally,
yeah,
we are starting with perhaps my favorite book. So anyway, guys, I hope you enjoy this episode. We hope to see you next week and goodbye.